So I'd like to welcome you all to the second conversation in digital humanities. My name is John McKenzie, and I am a Dean's Fellow for Media and Design in the College of Art and Sciences, and I'm also a visiting professor, and I teach games and digital design, and we do some games. We're starting to teach that next year, but tonight we have faculty from the engineering and
CIS. I'm in computer science.
Computer science, two colleges represented here, who are involved with Cornell's game design minor. And I'd also like to remind you, on Thursday, November the 17th, we have a presentation called The Lit Room, Augmenting Children's Read-Alouds Through an Interactive Cyber-Physical Environment. That's a presentation by Professor Keith Evan Green, who is over in the Design Environmental Analysis. So for humanists, what we're going to see is how narrative plays out in games and also how literature becomes an interactive environment. Before we start, I want to introduce the digital humanities librarian, Eliza Bettinger, and she has a few announcements. And I'll...
Hi, everybody. My name is Eliza Bettinger. I'm a very new librarian here at Olin, working with digital humanities. And I just wanted to make sure everybody knows we have a few new groups, events going on. One of them is Friday afternoons. We meet up in on the seventh floor in a conference room. Anybody from across disciplines who is working on some sort of digital project and is looking for fellowship, community, help with problem solving, ideas, motivation, any kind of questions that you might have. It's librarians and students sort of working together. We also have gearing up. If there's anybody here who's interested in computational text analysis, text mining, that kind of thing, if you have a project that you're working on, you're looking for support with, if it's a project that's humanities related, we have a group, a peer group kind of starting up for support and problem solving and motivation that's going to be meeting on a regular basis. So let me know if you're interested in learning more about that. I think I'll just put my NetID on the board. If you want to get in touch, please do. Okay, thanks a lot.
All right, Eliza, thank you. So tonight, one other thing I wanted to announce is that I'm trying to organize a meeting with Andrew Piper, who is going to be coming through here. The media studies are bringing him in. He also does computational analysis. He's coming, I think, on November 17th. And I'm trying to arrange in a meeting with the graduate students here. I'd like to just do a brief survey here. How many humanists do we have in the room tonight? Excellent. How many engineers or CIS folks do we have here tonight? All right, a nice gathering. And the rest of you are non-aligned. Architecture, excellent. Okay, wonderful. Anybody else want to shout out where you're coming from? We haven't heard from? All right, I'm in English, so okay. All right. So our presenters this afternoon are Walker White and Tracy Nathans-Kelly. Walker is senior lecturer in the Department of Computer Science, and he is the director of Cornell's Game Design Initiative and runs the interdisciplinary undergraduate Games Design minor. He teaches the core courses, CS Info 3152, Introduction to Game Design, and also CS Info 4152, Advanced Topics in Game Design. Walker Research publishes and presents on game design. And over here, we have Tracy Nathans-Kelly. She's a senior lecturer in engineering communications program. And what she does is hones students' communication skills within these game design courses. And she brings her training in literary studies to the study and creation of games. And as you know, there's been a long battle between, the ludologist and the narratologist.
We will talk about that.
Okay, all right.
We'll talk about that.
Getting in your territory there, sorry. She is also the co-author of Slide Rules, Design, Build, and Archive Presentations in the Engineering and Technical Fields, and I believe she is an editor with Wiley. See, if you got some publishing pretensions, you might go over and chat her up a little bit. Tonight's presentation is titled Game Design, Building, Computing, Bridging.
Yes.
Sorry.
It's okay.
That's right. I'm just an English professor. Let me start that again. Game Design, Bridging Computing, Humanities, and the Arts.
take it away.
All right. So before I start, I have written, we've made a certain presentation assuming a certain audience here, and I want to sort of start off to see whether or not our audience assumptions are correct or not. How many people are here who are like either faculty, staff, or graduate students? A couple of you, right? And how many of you are undergraduates here trying to improve your chances of getting into my course next semester? Okay. Oh, okay. Thank you for being honest, right? Okay. Just to let you know. Should turn this on. So John already talked about my intro, right? So I'm a senior lecturer in computer science. My area of expertise in education is project-based courses. I teach the game design courses as well as the introductory courses. This is my 800 student semester, as opposed to my game design courses, which were my smaller semester. The game design initiative, we call it that. It primarily houses the game design minor, but it also we also have an outreach program for the Ithaca area schools, generally sort of middle school, some high school, right? So there are a bunch of things sort of underneath their umbrella. One of the key things I wanted to point out on this slide, however, is that my undergraduate training is actually not in computer science. I come from a math and philosophy background. And one of the reasons why I point this out is that I'm a very strong believer in liberal arts education. I am not some STEM interloper here, right? So just sort of let you know a little bit about my background. And so I'm going to pass over here if anything you want to say that John didn't point out.
So, yeah, my training, I got my PhD in traditional English literature sort of thing. So my master's degree and my undergraduate were ancient languages, for example, and Shakespeare and all those good things. By the time I got to my PhD, I'm over in feminist theory, autobiography, Native American prose. And then I had this career refocus, and if any of you are interested, I'll let you know the gory details of that, right? But it was willing. It was a willing move on my part. And so I came into engineering communication through that path. I've been hanging out with Walker for about 4 years. And so, again, we both wanted you to know that we've seen both sides of campus, right? And that we understand.
I've been into this building for maybe 3 years.
Yeah, he was admitting that on the way in. And so we're going to start there. So Walker's going to start us out today and work us through some of the more theoretical bits. And then I'll come back at the end and walk us through, like, what happens in this class? What do the students do? How does this play out in real life?
Yeah. Good. So, in fact, one of the things we wanted to do was we just sort of wanted to set you up for some questions to think about today, right? As I said, you know, the audience that I assumed was that many of you are a faculty, staff, or graduate students coming from the digital humanities bent and are props not coming from the same STEM bent that we are. And so the questions to be thinking about is, when we talk about an author, what do we mean, right? So that one of the things that you're going to see in today's talk is words that look familiar, but we use them in very different ways, all right? So what do we mean when we talk about an author, particularly in game design? How do games complicate this definition? And so if you have a course, right, if you have a course where you're talking about authorship in various forms, if you want to bring games into that course, how does this complicate that discussion, right? So that's really what I want us to think about. Before I get into those questions, I'm going to start off with basically talking about just a little bit about the program that we have in order to set ourselves up here. So when we have our interdisciplinary courses, the goal in these courses is to make a complete, shippable, running game. My course is not a theory course. My course is not, hey, I'm going to propose a game that might be cool if somebody made it for us. No, we build everything, all right? And because of that, I need to have lots of people involved. Of course, I need to have programmers, but a game with only programmers is a really bad game, right? It's not particularly interesting, right? So I've got to have artists as well. They're also what we call UX designers. These are what come from information science. These are the people that sort of look at sort of the storyboards of how you might interact with the game and sort of the setups of the menus and the buttons. There's also digital composers. We have a great music program that does a lot of digital music on this campus. Ironically, they're the group that I can get away with dropping easily because it's a lot easier to find royalty-free music than it is to find art that actually fits. But the key thing is that all of the courses work in six-person teams. So to get into my course, you basically apply and you tell me what sort of role you want to be, and then I make my teams at the start of the semester. Applications are open up for next semester right now. and I will probably get 200 applications for 72 slots, is what I will get, right? The way they propose all their ideas at the start. I don't give them anything. These are all entirely their own ideas. They prototype every 2 weeks. We have some lecture into the class, but it's actually a lot of in-class critiques, right? So in some sense, it's like this weird hybrid between a very technical, almost computer science course and an art studio course in many, many different ways. And there's a lot of regular playtesting. Their final exam at the end is a public showcase. And by public, I mean public. I advertise in the Ithaca Times, Ithaca Journal, Ithaca Voice. We had, I think, 1,500, was it, people showed up last year or something like that. And I often tell the students, right, if you think I'm a hard grader, just wait until a 12-year-old gets a hold of your game. You do not know the meaning of brutal, right, until that actually happens, right? And audience response does affect their grade in some sense in how these things work. Now, you could sort of think, hey, okay, there is this such thing as a job in the game industry. Is this some sort of pre-professional program? I do send a lot of people to industry, but one of the things that I'm really trying to do in my courses is really explore games in a more artistic sense. So a lot of our students submit to juried festivals. I just had 8 teams at the Boston Indie Games Festival about a month ago. This game right down here, Gathering Sky, has been particularly successful, not only at Boston, but at Casual Connect. And last year, it was an honorable mention at the prestigious Indie Games Festival, which is held at GDC. They've had a very successful Steam release, as well as a release on iOS platforms and Android as well. Right, so a lot of very sort of serious development going on in these games. And one of the things is you'll notice over here, off to the side, I have a lot of these machines over here. Many of the games that we're going to show in this talk are available for people to play, right, and sort of look at and sort of interact with, depending on how we reach them in the course, right? Now, with that said, I currently sit in a computer science department, so you would think that, well, my course is very, very technical, and it is in some degree, but I'm not trying to teach programming to artists, because that's just crazy talk. Okay, not that they can't do it, but they have enough to do with art in a game with why am I asking them to do programming on top of that, right? But what is true is that my courses are very, very ludic, all right? So when we talk about, so this is one of these terminologies that I'm going to be doing in today's lecture. When we talk about ludic, we're talking about how the game is played. Sometimes people call this the game mechanics, all right? So an example of this is if you've ever played like a pen and paper role-playing game like D&D or something like that, where it's a lot of tables and numbers that you roll, this is an example of sort of a ludic system. These things are often very technical. Sometimes they involve understandings of probabilities or of fairness, but it's not quite the same technical aspects that you would have in programming. And because it is a technical topic, it is a lot of work to get it right, to get these games to be interesting, okay? So a lot of the course is spent on these types of things. Now, right away, this gives us an example of a term that means one thing in literature that means something totally different in gaming. When we talk about a genre of games, we're not talking about the same thing that we talk in literature about, say, Western or sci-fi or a mystery. When we talk about a genre of games, we're talking about a set of ludic conventions, right? The mechanics that are around those particular games, right? So role-playing games are a genre. Is it fantasy? Is it Western? Is it sci-fi? I don't care, but they all have very similar ludic conventions with how the mechanics work. First-person shooters have another set of conventions, as do sort of real-time strategies. So anybody's talking about a genre of games, they're talking about sort of the ludic aspects of that game. All right. Now, in addition to that class, which I just talked about, the game design minor relies on a whole bunch of courses, and I'm just one guy. Well, there's myself, there's Tracy, and then there's Eric Anderson also in computer science. But to fill out the minor, we rely on a lot of courses, and what's interesting is that a lot of our courses actually come outside of CIS. Many of them actually come from arts and sciences. There are a lot of great courses on this campus. Like, so COM 4220 is actually a psychology course that talks about the psychology of entertainment. Maria Fernandez's in art history has this great class on the history and theory of digital art. Performing and Media Arts is a class on creative character design, which I'm going to give a shout out to later in the talk. And then next semester in the music department is being offered a course called Music and Digital Gameplay, where how sound affects how it is, you know, your enjoyment and how you interact with the game. And I really like a lot of the stuff that goes in the music department on this campus. Audio is one of those things that could very easily, when you look at other people who have game design programs, could turn into sort of like a very almost pre-professional style approach of how you do audio design. And we have a really great music department that really sort of explores not only this, but also Warren Cross, I think it's Roger Cross, I've now mixed his name up, sorry. There's another course in soundscapes, which deals with sort of like the theory of music and how it does interacts with gameplay. By the way, this is a very different approach than other schools. What happens is, so there are quite a few schools now that have a game design major. And what they often do is they have a department of new media, and they would have taken all of these courses in-house. And they would have hired faculty specifically to do those types of things. That's not our philosophy here at Cornell. I am not threatened by these courses. I love these courses. We have world-class faculty in all of these other departments. I would rather use them than compete against them, right? So it's really great, and I really do depend on these types of courses. However, so now this is where we're going to set ourselves up into to the theory part. There is unfortunately something that's being lost on this campus because we're sort of trying to do things with a small number of courses, and that is unfortunately storytelling. So pre-2008, my teams had writers, right? So you could, in addition to that artist and composer and the programmers and the UX designer, we'd also have writers on the team. And the teams hated the writers. They were okay people, but they felt that they weren't carrying their own weight, right? Because the problem with a writer is they have grand ideas, so they're sort of they're steering the design of that particular game, but they're not actually doing anything to bring that game to fruition. And the industry as a whole like really hates that. And my teams really hated that as well. And part of the reason for that is that just designing a game by itself is really hard. And adding a story itself is really hard. And a lot of times the story is the first thing to drop. Or at very best, it sort of feels tacked on. So this is a picture that I show in like the second lecture of my course where I'm warning students about story. And they come away from the slide going like, oh God, he hates story. We should never have story in our games. And it's not that I hate story, it's just that I hate bad story in games. So one of the things we have to think about in a game is what can the player do? This is a classic thing that you might see in a game that has a story of like a picture of two people and they're having some sort of dialogue between them. What is the one thing you see on this slide that a player can do? Skip. That's not particularly interesting, right? So what that's showing here is the storyteller is designing a story, and the game designer is designing a game, and these are two totally unrelated products. And that's not what I want to have, right? That is not desirable. So one of the things that we have to understand is that storytelling in games is really, really different, okay? And a lot of people are tempted to look at games through a lens of film, or look at through games through a lens of literature. And in fact, one of the things I'm going to be pointing out today is, why is that bad? That's not only bad for games as critique, that's bad for games as design, okay? So when we talk about story in games, right, we've obviously got the author of the game who's designing my storyline, often designing these characters and the like, and we also have the player's perspective in here as well. Now you might say, okay, well that's not really different than a book, right? For a book, I have the author for the book, and I don't really want to discard how the reader interacts with the book. That's really different though, right? I mean, people, like, you also can have a viewer of a game, right? People who are watching these game, people play these games, and there's an entire market for this. This is why Twitch exists. But this interaction between the viewer and the author is very different than the player and the author, right? The player can do things like change character motivations or change the progression of the plot. So much so that this is really, like, I actually don't talk about this as perspective. I talk about this as voice, right? The author has a voice in the story, and the player has an equal voice, all right? And a lot of times, this makes people who look at storytelling in games really, really uneasy. So Roger Ebert, in the early 2000s, sort of infamously said that he didn't think that games could ever be art. And if you actually looked at his argument, the argument that he was making was the only way that it can be art is if it comes from the author voice. And he was very, very uncomfortable with having anything that had a very strong player voice to that being considered art. Interestingly enough, right, so in recent years, people are becoming more and more comfortable saying, okay, this is really an art game, or this game is more like art. But some of these examples of this, which we will look at, the reason why people are comfortable calling them art is because they have really strong player voice and they have muffled the voice of the player. And from my experience, that's not interesting. That means that my notion of games of art is being held to the standards of other media, which are holding it back, right? And I don't want that to be the case. All right. So one of the things that is true, right, so again, some sort of terminology here. When we talk about the author voice in games, this is what we call the narrative. All right. Now, once again, this is a term that we use different than they use in, than you would use in literature, right? Often in literature, when you talk about what makes the narrative different from the story, the narrative is, you know, the ordering of events and how the events relate to one another. Ironically, in games, that definition was what is more likely to be in control underneath the player, right? So really, I'm just sort of, when I say narrative in games, I'm saying that aspect of the story that is created by the author and is in some sense sort of unmalleable, right? That is fixed in some sense, all right? And this is going to involve a lot of traditional story techniques. A lot of it is borrowed from film, as we'll see here in a second. Whereas in the player is speaking with game mechanics, right? And you might think, oh, goodness, the player can do anything. Well, not exactly, right? We talked about ludic, right? There are these rules. There are these game mechanics, right? The game mechanics determine the boundaries of what the player can do. And more importantly, they define the consequences of those actions. And those consequences of those actions, right, can have a really strong effect on the story, okay? So this is the key thing that I need to point out is a lot of times when people want to study story in games, they only want to look at the narrative part. And they want to pull the player out of this completely. And what I'm going to argue here is not even in the games of today and yesterday can we do this, but certainly in the games of tomorrow, we cannot understand story without understanding how gameplay fits into it as well. All right. So the easy case of doing story, in a lot of games that you see right now, they follow this cinematic storytelling. And this is, these are the types of games that are very easy to analyze in, say, a traditional film or literature class, right? So I know at one point here, I think the English department had a course on the Western, and they studied Red Dead Redemption in that course on the Western. And that's because Red Dead Redemption is one of these games here, where the idea is that the gameplay and the storyline are largely separate. Like, the author has sort of created, you could think of this as maybe like cutscene, 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 where if I put them all together and I removed the player, I would have some video that I could show on YouTube that would essentially be a movie. It doesn't have to be cutscenes. There are other game story vehicles as well. But for the most part, the only thing that the player is doing is their success or failure is determining whether or not they get to see more of the story or not. Largely, their actions have been relegated to that, okay? The classic example of this is The Last of Us, all right? So you hear a lot of people talk about how Last of Us is this, you know, fantastic cinematic game. It's this game that's proved that games can finally be meaningful and they can be art. And the problem is that the gameplay is entirely subservient to the story. When people talk about The Last of Us, they talk about how good the story is. Nobody talks about this as a good game. nobody talks about. This is a good game, right? And in fact, some people, like when we talk, I'll talk about ludonarrative dissonance and again in a bit, some people point out that actually the gameplay gets in the way of the story, right? Now, it is true that this gameplay is not so bad. So what happens in the gameplay in Last of Us? So it's a zombie survival shooter, and what happens is that while you're playing the gameplay elements, it's hiding, it's making the emotional stakes get stronger. So therefore, when the author takes over, and when you're starting to see the narrative elements, it has that much more effect on you. And it does increase some character empathy, but for the most part, I really have no effect over the story at all, right? There's very little that I can do there. So this is where you hear people talk about ludonarrative dissonance. All right, ludonarrative dissonance is when you have way, way too much separation between gameplay and narrative, and so switching back and forth between those in this cinematic storytelling mode is very sort of jarring. So the classic example from the last generation of ludonarrative dissonance is BioShock Infinite. So once again, this has sort of this touching story between yourself and this character, Elizabeth. It's not necessarily a romance, it's sort of a more platonic story. There's more to it, but I don't want to go into spoilers for the story. But for the most part, you have that story during the cutscenes, but during the gameplay, it's basically, I'm just shooting people left and right, and her role in the gameplay is to throw you ammo when you run out. And that's all she does, right? So there's this huge disconnect here between these two things. And this is just a very natural thing when you just say, I'm going to be an author, I'm going to write my story, and I'm going to ignore what the player is doing, right, when I do these types of things. Now, there have been some attempts recently to still have this cinematic storytelling, but try to pull in the player a little more. And the easy way to do that is, well, we know about nonlinear storytelling in film or books. As the author, I'm willing to release a little control there, right? I'm willing to say, okay, I'm going to write the story, I'm going to write all the chapters, but the order in which you experience them, I'll allow the player to do that. So this is her story. This game works as sort of an interactive mystery where you can sort of look at these police, like you get sort of this computer right here, which have sort of viewings while she's being interviewed at the police station. You can view these in any sort of order, and doing so sort of unveils more of the story over time. But even so, the gameplay here is pretty minimal, so much that when you go to the Wikipedia, and this is controversial, people call this an interactive movie and not a game, all right? So once again, what's going on here is the gameplay unveils the story, but still the story is entirely the author's when you're looking at this. Am I missing something? Oh, I must be missing a slide. I don't know how that happened. So one of the things I'll mention here is, this is the slide that is missing. These cinematic games are actually largely a result of technical limitations in the last generation of consoles. So when you look at the consoles that came out around the time of the Xbox 360 and the PS3, it was this massive graphics jump from all these previous consoles to the point where I could actually have movies that were sort of on the level of a very cheap sort of animated movie, right? So I could have something that's really sort of compelling as a movie, but these devices were extremely underpowered. They had, you know, 512 megabytes of memory and very little RAM. The phone in your pocket these days is far more powerful than an Xbox 360. So what this meant is, because they had this great video stuff, it's really easy for me to just make a standard sort of video, like a DVD, right, where I display all these cutscenes for you. But now when you want to start having the player sort of interact with the world, well, that gets a little harder. So I'm a lot more limited there. This has changed with the more recent generation. What we've seen in the more recent generation is a very negligible jump in graphics, but an extreme jump in processing power and memory, which means that we're moving more towards sort of these open world games, where the user can go anywhere and could do anything, and I have all sorts of mechanics that you can use to sort of explore what's going on. So this is from Grand Theft Auto, right? Which, I mean, a lot of us think is sort of like a sociopath simulator. But there are stories, right, in Grand Theft Auto. But the thing to understand is that now what we see is actually, it's almost more serialized or more episodic storytelling going on here than what we saw in sort of the cinematic story of it. It's this long sort of thread that goes throughout the entire story. So what this means now is that now I have this case where the person can actually make choices in the narrative. Now you might ask yourself, why can't I make choices in the cinematic storytelling? Because every single time that you make a branch in the story, you are doubling the amount of voice actors and animation that I have to do. And so that's incredibly expensive. So I'm not going to allow you to make a lot of choices in the cinematic style. But if I'm doing things that are sort of very episodic, where really you're just sort of interacting with sort of like a little short story at a time, now it's actually a lot more feasible for me to allow you to have choices. So what happens is you'll notice that in these games, the narrative is largely restricted to a bunch of individual quests. So the narrative is the framework of giving me motivation for this quest that I want to do in the game and gives me some sort of reward, right, when the quest is over. And then what happens is now your story is, it's sort of like these classic sort of pulp, you know, short stories of old. My story is now a mix and match of all of these stories, right? Now, you can already see what the problem might be here. The problem is now I have an issue of narrative cohesion, right? So these, by the way, are from Skyrim. That is the Thieves Guild's quest. That is the Mage Guild's quest. That is the Companions Guild's quest. And that is the Assassin's Guild quest. A lot of these guilds hate each other. I think the Assassin's Guild hates the Thieves Guild. And you can be in charge of all of them at the same time. Because why not? Right. Actually, no, we know why, because Bethesda used to try to be a little more clever to this and give you some narrative cohesion of when you did one choice in one short story plot line that would cut off all your choices in other short story plot lines, and they discovered that their players hated that. So they would rather have, allow people to do everyone, even if it perhaps doesn't make narrative sense here, right? So notice now, you could call this ludonarrative dissonance, but putting that underneath that sort of term sort of masks that this is really different, right? Now what we have here is that the narrative subservient to the gameplay, right? That's what's going on here. There is, in this generation, a success story that is already broken out as sort of like doing this right. This is Witcher 3, which came out in the previous year. This is an open world game. It is based on a series of books by a Polish author named Sapkowski. It is, as many people talk about it, the first hard-boiled detective fantasy story ever made, because most of the stories are very episodic and they are held together by these themes. But now what has happened is this game has made this lack of cohesion a plus, because you are not a hero in this game, right? In many ways, this is Polish, a lot of sort of very Eastern European fatalism in here. No matter what you can do, you cannot make the world a better place. You are often hated for your actions, right? And so a lot of the meaningless of what you do is not that important. Now, they also help things because they do have a cinematic overstory in this game. But what's fascinating is you are not the protagonist of that cinematic overstory. This is a father-daughter story where you have this daughter named Siri that you are trying to find and rescue. And actually, this is her story. And the boss fight is this fascinating, just almost sort of deconstructive look at the boss fight. You don't fight the boss fight. She fights the boss fight, and whether or not she is successful or not is how good a father were you to her during the game. So this is a very, very different way, right, that we've looked at this. And so this allows most of your choices in the game to sort of be episodic, but I can still have some this sort of cinematic overstory to all of this. By the way, this actually goes back, if you think about it, to sort of the early days of gaming. A lot of people think that role-playing games came out of Tolkien. They did not come out of Tolkien. Tolkien is a very monolithic novel. They actually came out of the pulp stories, the pulp episodic stories of the 30s and 40s. And we know this because the original Player's Handbook for D&D had this thing called Appendix N, which was Inspirational Guide for Reading, and it really talked about you should be reading sort of these episodic pulp stories because these are ways that you can do storytelling but give the player a lot of control about what's going on here, right? Okay, so what we've seen now is I will make an argument that like these pure cinematic games are sort of like these games of the past. And we're seeing now sort of these more episodic games being these games of the present. For the future, but episodic storytelling is still very traditional, right? So the author has very, very strong control over the plots and characters. The player has some choices over which paths to check and how they might actually connect to one another. But what if we could push this a little further, right? What if we could actually get the author to give up certain amounts of control so that the story is incomplete without the player, right? So could you have like the author completely relinquish control over the plot? Now that's an interesting question. Well, what's left? What does the author do in that? Well, there are characters, right? We have to decide what the characters do and what their motivations are. And this is really interesting. When we actually look at what BioWare is doing a lot these days, their writers are actually writing characters more than they are writing plot. What if the author relinquished control of the characters? Is there anything left there? Would we call that a story? What's going on there, right? So in fact, really what's happening is it's almost like what we want to do is we want to really push this controversial question of how much can I let you go, cause you to let go before we don't call this a story anymore, right? So by the way, separating plot and characters, we're already doing that, okay? So in a lot of these role-playing games, particularly that come out of BioWare, the player is the protagonist and the player drives the plot, but the author is controlling the characters. So you might have an author on each individual character. That person will write that character's backstory, that character's motivations. They will write how that character might react to various actions of the player. And it's now almost, notice what happens is that the storytelling becomes a game. Because whether or not they become my ally and they join me in my story depends on whether or not I'm doing things that are in line with their motivation. So now the reaction, the relationship between the player and the author becomes a lot stronger, right? It almost got a little too far. Actually, in BioWare's games, they really sort of gamified it a little too much where everybody had sort of these friendship bars where I could do things like give them gifts and they would become more friends of me and they would join me along. They stopped doing that because there were a lot of complaints, right? So now it's much, much more seamlessly put into the story, and I think they did a much, much better job with that with their most recent game being Dragon Age Inquisition. You can actually go further than that, right? So notice what we're talking now is that storytelling actually becomes this ludic act. So this is a scene from Facade, which is now a decade-old game, but it has not come close to being replicated ever again. This is, you're at a party with two friends from high school whose marriage is definitely on the rocks, and depending upon how this conversation happens while you're at their apartment, you can either sort of like cause the marriage to fall apart or get back together or whatever. And the key thing about this is that the writers haven't, at least when you're looking at BioWare games, the character's a fairly monolithic entity. In Facade, what happens is that the writers have written story beats. Like, this is the story about when I made this particular drink at the bar. Or this is the story when Grace brought up the fact that Tripp, who is her husband, has been holding her back in her career aspirations. Each one of these things are different stories, and depending upon how you interact with them, you can hijack stories, you can further different stories, you can get different stories to move on, and so as a result, it's like you have this almost sort of completely emergent story going on here. This is an early project by Mike Mateus at UC Santa Cruz, who is really sort of one of the most foremost experts out there on interactive narrative. The reason why this has never been replicated is this is really hard to write, right? I understand this from a technical standpoint, but now you need an author, right, to write these types of things. And this is really, really hard, okay? So let's suppose I let go even more, right? If I don't have characters, do I have any story at all? Well, there is this notion of world building, right? So you could have, like, I have to define what actions the player can take, right? What things the player can do in the game. I have to define the consequences of those actions. And maybe I want to define something like scripted events that might happen to the player. This is almost sort of like acts of nature more than actually other characters. But the idea is that the author control of characters is very, very limited. The author just sort of controls the base motivations, perhaps not what they actually do, and all else is assigned to the player. So now you're almost thinking about like Sims or something like that. We don't perhaps think that Sims has a great storyline, but this is another better example. So this is This War of Mine. And this is an art game by a company that makes a lot of games like this. And the idea is that you're essentially, it's undescript area during war, but you could think of it as modern day Syria or World War II Poland, right? Where you're in this sort of burnout area and you're just trying to survive, right? And you've got a bunch of people and they're going about and they're sort of scavenging for stuff and they're either helping each other or maybe some people are slacking off and not doing anything. If you don't secure it overnight, people can come in and rob you. You can choose to rob other people as well. The author has very, very little control over this story, but the world building and the fact that having certain actions have, you know, very important consequences on your character gives a meaningful emotional response to what's going on here. So a story is unfolding here, even though it's very much under the control of the player. All right. We could push this even further, right? So you could just say, okay, forget world building. Now the author is just somebody who drives the player emotion. And so now you've noticed, by the way, that there are two terms that I keep saying over and over again, right? The author sort of defines the actions that the player can take, and the author defines the consequences of these actions. As a game designer, I'm not willing to let go of those two, right? At the very least, that has to be done in order for us to have a game, because if it's an interactive thing, I have to know what can the player can do and what are the results of those actions. And there is a lot of control over here. So this is Flower on PS4, which is really just meant to sort of be a very exploratory game where you go through a sort of like this herd of flowers and float through the environment, and it's supposed to give a very sort of emotional impact to that. This is very similar. So I talked about Gathering Sky that we had at IGF last year, and I have it to play here in a second. In this game, you control a flock of birds. And one of the interesting things about this is as you fly through the birds, you fly through different environments, right? So this is a very open sort of exploratory environment. There's another environment where there's sort of obstacles in the way that might break up my birds and cause them to separate from one another. There's another time where it's much more scary and I'm flying in a thunderstorm, right? And that these environments give me very different sort of emotional impacts of what's going on here. Another interesting thing about this game is there's no clear protagonist here, right? You really sort of identify yourself with this flock of birds, right? And so when they're threats, there's threats to the entire flock, but not perhaps a single bird. But now we get into the question of, is this storytelling or is this just digital art? And this is actually, I mean, this is an interesting debate, right? And there are people on sort of either sides of this. But the reason why I have broken us down to this is because making a game is a really, really complicated thing. And this level of storytelling is the type of thing I can do in a semester. Okay? This is the type of stuff. Whereas if I were going to have any other sort of storytelling, it would have to be done in a different class other than me, because this is about as far as we can go, right? And Gathering Sky was a great, great success for us, right? So I think what we want to point out is that because I can't do a lot of this in my courses, that when we talk about writing and the author in our courses, it is going to have to take its way through sort of other outlets. So that is where I'm going to pass over to Tracy, because this is where she takes care of me.
Oh, isn't that nice? Yeah, probably. And will you start these around for
sure.
Me? Thanks. So what Walker's going to start around are some of the, we take the digital out and we make it physical. And at the end, we talked about showcase, right, where we invite the community and everybody else in to play these games, including my herd of my son and all, he's the 12-year-olds, right? And so I scold all the students, like, if you make my kid cry, you're going to get an F, right? So don't do that with your games. So I always joke around with them. So we bring all these folks in, but one of the things that we ask the students to do, and this is what's coming around, are these old time, right? You don't see game manuals anymore, but this is an analog expression of what the story is about, how it's told, and what the player's responsibilities are as a good player. I've got this backwards. And so some people always ask me, well, what do you do as the communication person inside a course like this? Short story. We have, what, 10 to 13 different documents with up to three revisions each, so there's a lot for us to do. But along the way, there's some really cool things that happen. Walker and I grade all the written documents together. So there's everything from architecture specs all the way down to your design objectives and everything in between. Lots of different kinds of documents coming in about every 10 days, 2 weeks or so. And so all of these pieces, there's all kinds of deliverables, right? So level design, what's gonna happen in each level? Why is it happening? What's going on there? What are the interactions? So they have to define, they have to pick specific verbs, right, in order to make things happen. So we drill down to single word pieces. All of these things start to come together for the students, and this is very hard for them, and so that's why we do lots of revisions, so that they can really wrap their heads around the storytelling versus the verbs versus outcomes versus interactions. It's not an easy thing to do. Along the way, we also ask them to think about some of these other layers, so the music. So this is an example from one of the design documents about how the music, we want to accentuate. This is a relaxed feel in this game. We want them to be pleasantly surprised, nice moods, so on and so forth. So evoking an atmosphere, if you will, which is a different thing than giving the player motivation. Okay, so they start to pull apart what it is they want even their sounds to accomplish as people become immersed inside of their games. And it's an important point for them to pull apart. This is also the fun part for me. I'm not a big gamer. I'm not. Like, I love Myst, right? When did that come out?
Myst is a great game.
Like 1984 or something, right? I love it. I love it. But, like, and then so this is me, right? I'm like, ooh, look at this pretty one. And then I go play this one, right? So this is where I come from. But I tell the students all the time, I'm not a good gamer, and this is why I'm a great person to be inserted into this class. Because if I don't get it, nobody else is either, especially out in the public. So there's lots of little things that come along the way. Sometimes we do have basic character development, right? So we've got our squeak, and we've got grumpy enemy over here. Sometimes it starts out just that easy, but then the interactions become a little bit more demanding later on, perhaps. We brought Squeak and Swipe for you today. Too. Then we start to talk about what is the mood, what are the backgrounds, right? So this is where the author and the mood and the world building starts to play a part. We have bright lights shine. So I'm going to show you another picture from the same game. So this is our inspiration, right? Oh, look, other games are doing this. We want ours to be like that. So they're looking at other games, taking screenshots. We want something where bright lights shine. We want an expression, same game, of a very large world. So we're going to use parallax, kind of layering, right, to express a long shooting sort of landscape, if you will. This is how the game ended up. See, this is not an easy move. This is not an A equals B sort of moment for them. So we see our bright spots, right, in the background. We see some depth in there, but the translation for their motivation, author, player interactivity, all this is how the translation comes out. And this is a very fun game. We love this one at my house.
Also made
in Boston. Yes. So again, the difference between the artists and what they're accomplishing, how they impact the game, is very important. Because they work hard to make it pretty, to make it awesome, to make it cool looking, while everybody else makes it work. So here's an example of the artist's vision of what this digital world should look like inside the game. So this is the cover of their manual for Deserted, but this is what the game actually looks like. Okay, so we can see some of the artistic influence there, but it has to be translated into playability. I never got the hang of this game. You laugh at me, but I never got the hang. I never got it. These rock guys, I don't know. I could never get my head around it. So then there's also this nice thing that happens with the artists, if you will, about how they develop the way that the game moves through certain levels. So in Inari, this is their early design document again about, okay, we want to start off in a world that's not very hospitable. And then if they make all the right moves and they advance to the right next level, right, things start to look up a little bit. It's a little bit more friendly. We can start to see some vegetation. Humans can definitely live in here, right? Signs of life, right? Whereas we didn't have that before. And at the end goal is somewhere beautiful and lovely where we would want to build our cabin that we're escaping to, right? So the design inspiration helps the people creating the levels on the technical side of it, right? What's going to happen each level? What does it look like? What are the obstacles? All that. That comes to fruition through the artist's visions. And of course, they negotiate with their coders and all this good stuff about what that's going to be like. And here's an interpretation of that first world that they have. Isn't it beautiful? Like, you want that as your background on your computer, right? So we have lots of other things that happen inside the course, too. So this is where the communication pieces come in. This is an early design review. So we keep these pretty casual, but students do have to get up and give a talk. I make all of them get up there, right? And they're some of them still have their hands in their pockets, right? And they're doing all this stuff that they shouldn't do, probably. But they're up there, and they're doing it. And they're talking through the technical bits, and they're talking through the artistic bits at the same time in a room that's kind of a hectic place to be. They have game, so they have to script when they want to do game testing. What do we want to have happen? Who do we want to have test? What are the outcomes? What are the things that are bothering us we need feedback on, and so forth? So they actually have to write testing scripts, and this is something that we've just started to do in the last year and a half, and that's my kid right there. His face always turns red when somebody who he thinks is kind of cool is next to him, right? He loves hanging out with the cool kids. So he loves to come to testing day. And this was exhausting. My kid, I don't know how long other testers were in there, but Henry was in there for a good hour and a half, and he was toast when it was done. He was exhausted because they were on him. What about this? What about this? What about this? I mean, it's a very intense atmosphere. Also, so the game manual, you can pass these around so you guys can get a good sense of some of these are beautiful. They are art pieces in and of themselves.
Also at Boston Indy, and it was largely accepted at Boston Indy because of its artistic aspect.
Look at this, right? Who doesn't want this game? Just look at the cover. And me, I'm like, ooh, right? I get emotionally attached just immediately. So this is old-timey game manual stuff, but we see the story, right, start to come in. We also start to understand about gameplay, but also the emotional thing. There's something going on here with the kid and the father, and he's in a, I don't know, a pyramid, right? And things are chasing him. This is actually a very scary game to play. If your room is dark and you turn out all the lights, it's actually pretty darn scary to play. And I'm always screaming, it's coming after me, right? You get very emotional about these things. And this is one of our most beautiful manuals ever. So again, the story here is pretty simple. Bird trying to get through and become an awesome bird is what it comes down to. But look at this. I mean, my gosh, this, and here's the best page of all, right? So basically, you're a wee bird, and you want to become a master bird is what it comes down to. Very simple story. But moving through, right? But the comic book influence here, the all the new novels that have so many pictures in them now, whether they're color or just black and white, you can see the influence here. It is stunning. And so this is how all of these pieces for these students come together. And this is just in a one semester course. And other pieces that come in at the very end, so this is at Showcase. And so they have other kinds of deliverables. This is poster. We never know what the posters are actually going to look like till we show up. We're like, oh, man, this is cool. So isn't this adorable, right? This guy's he's a shadow. And you have to work with, your character is a shadow that you're trying to move through an atmosphere. But isn't this adorable, right? It tells the whole story right then and there. And so again, the whole team gets together to decide how it is they're going to draw. So this is marketing, right? How are they going to draw people over to their stations to play? So maybe they get more votes. So they're doing all kinds of interesting things. And this is more like a movie poster than anything else. I always think of Mike Wazowski right here. I don't know. He's not green, but he looks like Mike Wazowski to me. So yeah, they did a great job of turning this into kind of a movie impact there. And so all of these things start to come together in very, very complicated ways. And these takeaway thoughts are what we offer for you to think about ways that maybe you can bring ideas of storytelling, narrative, what students are capable of. You know what? They're capable of a lot more maybe than what you're willing to ask them. They always come through. They absolutely come through. And this is probably one of the hardest classes they take. It's five credits.
It's five credits.
We see them every day.
It's 10 hours of work a week outside of class, and I tell them if they can't do it, drop, because I've got 150 people trying to get in. They can't do that.
So,
but I mean, it's full. We would love to stick more stuff in the course, but we just can't.
Yeah.
My greatest dream on this campus would be for someone to teach an interactive narrative course, because I don't have the time to do it.
Yeah.
That is my greatest dream. That's one of the things that we are missing that a lot of our competitors have.
And I think that they are definitely capable of that as well. So what we kind of wanted to end with is, you know, pass these around, enjoy these. We can ask questions, answer questions.
And play stuff.
And we brought stuff to play if you want to play, because that's how much we love the work that they have done. So I guess I'll open up with questions real quick for either one of us. Don, did you want to do a in-between thing? Oh, okay. Yeah. Careful your coffee. Okay. Do you have any questions, comments, queries? Everybody just wants to play the games. So we threw a lot at you because we were thinking, what can we maybe bring to the English or digital arts? Go ahead, Guy.
So maybe more of a comment. I actually kind of want to challenge your last two bastions that you're protecting of action and consequences. Mm-hmm. Saying you could have players write scripts that have actions and consequences, and then they actually define new actions and new consequences.
So now what you're talking about, this happens in sort of modding, right, when sort of the player becomes sort of the designer as well. But there are still sort of, we still put rules on those, right? I mean, the problem is that if you don't put any rules or any sort of restrictions on it at all, then it just becomes, well, the player just sort of becomes an author in their own right. Now we're talking about sort of like the player is some sort of secondary author, right, that's sort of, you know, making their own story from their own sort of toolkit. I think by the fact that we sort of separate this notion of player and author, it's because the player has certain rules imposed upon them, right, that the author doesn't have. But it is true, right, that one of the things that you do see is there is a lot of expression that players do when they can mod games, right? When they can add their own art assets, they can add their own features. This happens a lot. In fact, game designers love to have players modding their games because, you know, sometimes you might think, well, but this means they're making their own content and they're not going to buy our content. Well, the number one thing that keeps people from buying your content is they don't play your game anymore. And as long as I'm actually interacting with them as their own creator, right, they're going to keep playing my game. I'm more likely to be able to sell them stuff.
Questions?
Do you want to fire up? What do you have on the iPad?
Yes.
I'm going to take it outside the box just a moment. We're here visiting. My son was visiting some classes today and checking out Cornell. He's a senior in high school, but I teach high school students, and I teach computer programming and applications and things like that. So, as a high school teacher, what sort of skills do we need to be teaching our kids so that they come in here ready to come in and do this kind of stuff? Because they love it.
Right. So a lot of it is, you know, have a passion and be good at something, right? I mean, so if we're talking about if you're doing this as sort of like a career or even just sort of like the festivals, right? My role as an educator is to help students build portfolios. And interestingly enough, from the humanities angle, everyone's like, oh, yes, portfolios. This is a natural thing that I build. For programmers, that's a really not something, right, that people think about, right? You know, oh, what do you mean a portfolio of all the stuff that I've made? I mean, I know skills, and I know how to prove this in an exam or if you challenge me in this, right? But what do you mean like a portfolio of things that you develop, right? Whereas, but, you know, when you... You know, when these, you know, you add, look at game get jobs at these game companies, you know, they do want to see, well, what have you done, right? What role, the best thing to do is to find a role that you're good at and something that you're sort of passionate about, right? Not everybody's the greatest at coding, right? Look, if you want a job in coding at like a really AAA company like Bungie or, Naughty Dog or something like that, you have to be the best programmer that I have graduated from this university for this year, okay? Because it's really, really, really sort of competitive, right? Or if you want to be sort of the artist, you need to be, you know, an incredibly, because there are a lot of people trying to get into this industry. So the right thing is you should be passionate at something. One of the things that we try to do in our program is pull people with these different passions together and help them sort of, you know, excel, right? So yes, I mean, you know, I've got stuff for coders, I've got stuff for artists, right? But the right thing to do is to have, you know, be passionate about something. The other thing that's true is there are a lot of great tools that make game development somewhat easy to help students get started these days. I mean, Unity has a somewhat low bar to get used to. But then there are sort of a lot easier things like Game Maker and the like. And while the types of games that you'll make from those tools won't allow you to reach a lot of the types of deep questions that we were trying to talk about here, it'll at least get you started so that I have you started at a different place, right? So we can push a little farther, or those types of things.
And I would say to follow just on what you just said is the critical thinking.
Yeah.
Right? Just be willing to always ask why not, or what about something different. So like I said, when I started, I was ancient languages, you know, doing that whole thing, medievalist, gonna go down that route. No, I'll do this and this. And then at a certain point, I just stopped. I'm like, this is not what I want to do. I want to do something where there's a concrete outcome, right? And now I'm in digital art things, right? So concrete, in air quotes. Right, exactly. And I've got posters and the manuals. But for me, I needed a switch. And so coming from literature, I had to figure out what that meant. And so for me, it was a path towards something more concrete as outcomes. And so the critical thinking of making specific choices for very specific reasons, but then always being able to wrap back, right, and double check and ask, well, what about also this, that critical thinking moment, right? And you've got them in high school, so that's the moment to start up.
And there's one more thing I should add to think about, particularly if you're coming from a programming background, is the ability to take constructive criticism very well. Because this is an artistic discipline. It's fascinating in my courses. The art majors are like, oh, he's such a teddy bear. He's so nice. He pulls his punches. His critiques are never mean. And the programmers who have never had this done to them before are like, oh my God, he is so mean to us.
Right. And I can hear the artist, and I'm all about verisimilitude. And I said, you know what? They don't have that kind of cactus in Africa. Right? Like, they don't have that. And so you need to fix it. And I'm like, Tracy, and this was great. They said, willing suspension of disbelief. I'm like, all right, you got me, right? So they bring the literature right back at me. But this is where we start to go back and forth. I'm like, oh, she's so mean. Why is she so crappy all the time? Because I'm going for the very.
Because we're pushing them.
I need to make it make sense, right? Or else the game falls through.
We had 8 projects at Boston Indie this year, right? I was like, the problem was is that I promised them that if they get into Boston Indy, I will pay their way. And this year was like, oh God, I'm in the poorhouse. So,
other questions back here? Anyone? No, don't be shy. All right, hang on. Let me get back here.
This is just because we're taping.
I have a question about the points. As we move towards like the more open world model of gaming.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, you bring up Skyrim, of course, and one of the weaknesses of Skyrim is that once you're done with everything, there really isn't a sense of completion
right.
to it. And I mean, you can call that a weakness or you can call that a strength, because then people just keep playing it. Or, but where does the sense of accomplishment
So one of the things to think about is that, and I sort of talked about this with Witcher, is while I talk about these as sort of like different approaches, they don't have to be exclusionary, right? There was an overall cinematic story to Witcher as well. It was this interesting cinematic story that it ended when Ciri had her final moment, right? In fact, one of the most powerful things in the game is when your character is trying to go with her and Ciri says to him, no, this is not your story, this is mine. And she goes off, right? And this is where the game finishes and where the game completes. So there is a notion of finishing there, and that happens with the cinematic story. It's just that what we want to do is we don't want, the problem is there's this tendency when we have a cinematic story for that to be the only story. And how do we meld that with sort of more episodic storytelling? That's really, really hard. CDA Projekt pulled it off. They pulled it off with 2 years of crunch. I feel sorry for those employees. But, you know, it's... I'm not saying we've mastered this, but it's something that we're sort of continuing to sort of explore. We have one over here.
All right.
Thank you. I don't know if it's a question. It's more like a, I don't know, a commentary maybe. There are these open world games that also want or sell themselves as reconstructions of lost places. For example, I don't know, Assassin's Creed, where you can reconstruct Rome and Constantinople and different places. And I'm a historian. I'm very attracted to those games.
No, I like the Assassin. That's my wife's favorite series. Okay. Assassin's Creed. I know it well.
So yeah, it was more like a commentary about like this other potential. I don't know if it's a potential or not, but the idea of reconstructing places and this pedagogical. I don't know if it's the correct word, but that maybe the game is not just to game, but to place yourself in this like simulacrum of a lost world.
So,
of
so now past, what you're talking about is perhaps almost using sort of like the game as an educational environment.
Maybe.
That is interesting. That's actually, so Eric Anderson, who is the other faculty member who does games, that's actually his area, right? So he actually, one of his projects that he's done that you can actually play on the web is he has this world that's a simulation of Japan. And what's going on here is you can only interact with the other characters in the game by learning Japanese. And so this is actually a language learning game where the idea is it's supposed to, well, it's really expensive for us to go spend a year in Japan. But this, you know, this game can sort of simulate an immersive language education, right, in this particular environment. So there's definitely an exploration of that. That's, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. That's a totally different topic than what I was talking about today. But yes, no, it's one of the things is that I think it's just sort of really interesting. You know, I've been gaming for a long time. It's just sort of people sort of realizing sort of the power and the things that we can do with games. And this is really sort of, you know, starting to come into its own right now.
To your point, I was on a discussion board once and some people were asking, they wanted to, they had one of these immersive worlds. And I forgot where it was, right? But they wanted to have it be very realistic, and they were trying to develop a language for their characters. And so they were discussing what their alphabet would look like and what the sounds would be. So very, you know, linguistically interesting. But then I got mad, and I said, why not pull up one of these languages that are disappearing from the globe every day, right? Why not pull up one of these languages where we have the last living person who's still speaking it and insert that, a whole lot of your work will already be done for you, right? And so it became this really big discussion about, do we create something new? Is it respectful to revive something that is dying? Would we do it in the right way? So it was a cool discussion, right? And they ended up going forth in, you know, their own way in developing their own language, because the politics of using somebody else's language that they weren't immersed in to begin with, like from birth, was too heavy for them. They just wanted to go have some more fun. So it was a great discussion to have with those folks.
I mean,
and an important one, I think.
I mean, this is something that's affected Assassin's Creed, right?
Right.
The question of
cultural appropriation.
Right. There were the first game had many Muslims unhappy with the cultural appropriation in that game. And it was sort of interesting that then the later games moved to Italians, and the Italians were totally cool with it, even though it was all about the boars just killing everyone. So.
Are there questions out there? I have a question or two. The first one has to do about Myst, and in terms of the narrative ludic, because it definitely was a lot of, I guess you would call that, but problem solving, or
right.
and it was wrapped in a narrative.
Right, it was wrapped into a narrative, and really what was happening there was it was closer to her story. In the sense that what you had going on in Myst was there was a story, but it was unfolding, and the order in which it unfolded to me, and the type and the way that I experienced with that story was I had to earn it, right, from the problem solving.
And
right,
it was really hard to earn. I still have my Myst notebooks that I took right to solve the problems, and this is 15 years ago, but I worked so hard to solve those damn puzzles.
And I will say, so what is true, and so one of the things that we're seeing here is that certain types of gameplay, so now if we talk about genre, right, in the sense that people in literature use genre, certain genres work with certain types of gameplay, right? So that type of gameplay where the story is unfolding and I'm having to earn the unfolding of the story, that really works really well for mysteries, right? That's really sort of natural for it, right? Whereas in sort of like the episodic sort of, you know, hard-boiled detective story works well for these open world games, right? So what we're sort of noticing is that certain types of storytelling fit with certain game mechanics better than others. And it's something we're just only sort of now starting to understand.
Another question. You said that you really wish there was an interactive narrative class. What would that class do?
I think it doesn't even have to be a creative writing course, right? That people write their own stuff. But I think there's just enough games out there where we're sort of looking, you know, what I talked about with the player voice versus the author voice. What is the role of the player here, right? And how is the player either reinforcing or undermining the storytelling conventions or the goals of the author, right? In my mind, that's what one of these courses would teach.
And finally, so I can't, was it 20 or 30 years ago, the French theorist Roland Barthes wrote about the death of the author, and that the author would kind of fade away, and Foucault wrote about this as well. So, and maybe that explains, the author definitely still lives in English departments, and I'm wondering if that's why games don't get the credit, because of that weak author function. And you seem to be saying that the best games have this sort of weak author function, or one that is so transmuted it no longer looks like the literary author.
In my opinion, the things that I think of, because partly that's my bias, because I like game mechanics, right? That my area of study is actually game mechanics more than the game story, right? So I'm on the player's side there. That doesn't mean that I don't enjoy experiences that are more cinematic, like The Last of Us or whatever. But from my perspective as a creator and a designer, right, that's certainly the types of games that I like more of.
I don't think I would use weak author. I think I would use transparent, which is something different, mm-hmm. right? That whole world still needs to be constructed, inputs, outputs. It's very much still a controlled atmosphere. No matter how open, air quotes around that too, it is, the author still sits. Does anybody watch Once? Right, this thing that's like on NBC or ABC or something, right? There's an author in there who's writing and rewriting and unwriting and ripping apart old fairy tales. And they all start to crash into each other. And it's really, I was talking to you about this the other day, right? It starts to crash into each other. All these fairy tales we thought that we knew get unwritten by this kid with a magic pen who is the author. And so I think author is not necessarily weak, because the story has to be there in order for something to be enacted. But transparent, maybe? I don't know what the right word is. Somebody else was signaling. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just wondering, if the player is involved, I'm from literature, I guess reader response, how would you quantify reader response or player response beyond things like how many times somebody downloads something or how many times a specific action is taken? How do you relate to that? Because I know that some MMORPGs will like just monetize things in their worlds, so long as they have a certain amount of players interested in performing a certain activity, and that leads to the longevity of the game. I'm thinking.
This is a really interesting area. This is actually Eric Anderson's area, who does a lot of educational games, because he can study things very quantitatively, right? Because if I'm looking at games as an educational standpoint, I can look at things like, did you succeed? Did you fail? How many times did you fail before you started to succeed? When did you give up, right? Those types of things are very easy to quantify in terms of sort of when I'm using games as a pedagogical environment, which was a question over here. If I do it in a storytelling environment, this is really hard, right? A lot of times when people look at like how stories would resonate with people, they're not actually looking like, so all games record. All people record the data from players, and they do all sorts of big data analysis on this. But really, when you look at how a story, people respond to a story, what they're really looking at is like the Tumblrs and the Twitters, right? How people are responding to this online and how they're making their own stuff to be sort of contribute and be part of this world. And that actually seems to be almost sort of like a greater measure of how these things respond to the players than any sort of like, you know, sort of metric or metrizable data that I can gather from the game itself.
And the YouTube channels.
Yeah.
the YouTubes with the walkthroughs, and so you see, and so watch the comments, right? What happens there, and hated this, loved this, gonna try it this, how do you figure this out, right? Because if people are still banging away at trying to figure out a certain way out, and they're not giving up, right? So you can see all those comments in those YouTube walkthrough channels, for example, which my kid loves to look at. So, I mean, that's one another way. And so that data can be scraped fairly easily. And the ethics of that is something else to consider, right? But that's another
one. I also want to point out those videos, that's really great. So this is one of the places where we definitely see player story. So when you look at these, Assassin's Creed is really great for this, right? Where people are really just going to play with the AI. But they aren't just playing with the AI to explore the ludic space. They're doing things with the AI, and then they're retroactively putting stories onto this type of stuff. So one of the things, there's a website called The Hidden Blade, where people are like, you know, Assassin's Creed is about doing certain assassinations. Well, I want to do my own assassinations, and I want to do my own stories, and I want to do things in different ways. So like there's a classic thing in Assassin's Creed 2, right? The Pope, spoiler alert, is one of the bad guys, right? And this is the final mission that you have to do. And when you kill him, it causes, you know, you cut scene, you go to the next scene. Well, somebody wanted to, after the assassination, to have sort of like the cardinals react to this and be sort of still in the scene for a while before I go to the cut scene. So they figured out, oh, how can I still assassinate the Pope but keep the cut scene from firing, right? And so there are all sorts of explorations that people do here to be able to tell their own stories.
That's one way to talk about getting some numbers out of this, say, how's it working? Those data scrapes are going to be one way to get at it, at least for now. Who knows what's around the corner? Right?
Any other questions out there? Are we all gamed out? I think they've gotten never gamed out. Let's see. So you guys...
Yeah, we have plenty of stuff. So I will point out, if you want to stay... So I have on this device, this is my iPad Pro, later, do not upgrade. Yes, so the problem is I have a mixture of like my games and actual commercial games up here. So this is Gathering Sky right here, which I talked about where you sort of, in fact, I can select the different worlds here. All right, so if I wanted to, I can go to the, come on. Well, let me go to the thunderstorm. Play. Oh, I don't think I've made it to the thunderstorm in this playthrough. The problem is it doesn't carry over to certain devices.
So see, this is where it's interesting. You aren't a character here, right?
So anyway, I have this to play. We have Inari, which is the one she was talking about. So Inari is sort of a very sort of almost traditional sort of platformer. I can go... So if I go to sort of this, this takes me, timer is going to take me down to a different world. And so now, oh, this is the tutorial. Hold and tap causes me to jump like that. Tap.
We work a lot with them on tap, the tutorials,
tap,
like how
tap,
to teach people to do.
Tap, tap, come on. Oops.
Crash.
One of the in recent years, the advanced class has been more mobile because doing mobile controls is really, really hard. I do have some interesting games on the devices. So on this computer, I have Dash, which is the game with the really beautiful manual that she showed. It's an interesting game where the idea is that the bird has to keep moving or it falls out of the sky. So it's having to constantly keep moving, and it's sort of very simple but somewhat challenging. And I think I have Brought to Light on the Mac, which is the one that you showed with sort of the horror game. And then I have a couple other things on. And you said you have Squeak and Swipe on your mobile device?
Squeak and Swipe, the mouse with the Grumpy Cat on my phone.
Yeah.
And Beam, which is...
Oh, Beam, yeah, Beam is another... Beam, I think, got, what? I think they told me 5,000 downloads on Android or something like that.
Right.
So, but that's more of a puzzle game.
And it's in the
iStore. Yes. There we go.
Oh, it's on yours.
Yes, I have it as well. It's a great game.